Bhagavatam, Canto 4, Chapter 23, entitled Prithu Maharaj Goes Back to God's Feet, text number 30. Itam Bhutanu Bhavaso,
Itam Bhutanu Bhavaso,
Prithu Sahab Bhagavatama,
Prithu Sahab
Tashacharitam,
Tashacharitam,
Udama Charitashyate,
Udama Charitashyate,
Itam Bhutanu Bhavaso,
Itam Bhutanu Bhavaso,
Ritu Sa Bhagavatama,
Ritu Sa Bhagavatama,
Yatitam Tashacharitam,
Itam Bhutanu Bhavaso,
Itam Bhutanu Bhavaso,
Ritu Sa Bhagavatamaha,
Ritu Sa Bhagavatamaha,
Kirtitam Tasya Charitam,
Kirtitam Tasya Charitam,
Uddhama Charitasyate,
Uddhama Charitasyate.
Itam,
Itam,
Thus, Anubhava, very great, powerful,
Asau,
that,
Pritu,
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 Sa, Ti,
Bhagavat,
Tamaha,
Tamaha,
the best among the Lord,
the best among the Lord,
Kirtitam,
Kirtitam,
Describe.
Tashya.
His. Charitam.
Character.
Udara.
Udara.
Very great.
Very great.
Charitashya.
Charitashya.
One who possesses such qualities.
One who possesses such qualities.
To you. Maitreya continues. The greatest of all devotees, Maharaj Prithu, was very powerful, and his character was liberal, magnificent, and magnanimous. Thus, I have described him to you as far as possible. Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. In this verse, the word Bhagavatama is very significant, for the word Bhagavat is used especially to refer to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as the word Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is derived from the word Bhagavata. Sometimes, however, we see that the word Bhagavan is used for great personalities like Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva, and Narada Muni. This is the case with Prithu Maharaj, who is described here as the best of the Bhagavata, or the best of the lords. A person can be so addressed only if he is a great personality who exhibits extraordinary and uncommon features, or who attains the greatest goal after his disappearance, or who knows the difference between knowledge and ignorance. In other words, the word Bhagavan should not be used for ordinary persons. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnana Shurakaya Dastur Nirvikamena Tasmai Gurave Namah Vancha Taupata Rubyasya Kripa Sindhumaya Vacha Patitanam Pavaneyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namah Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Translation again, Maitreya continued, the greatest of all devotees, Maharaj Prithu, was very powerful, and his character was liberal, magnificent, and magnanimous. Thus, I have described him to you as far as possible. So Maitreya is describing to Vidura about Maharaj Prithu. He was describing about the descendants of Dhruva Maharaj. Initially, he talked about Dhruva Maharaj, and then he went on to speak about the descendants of Dhruva Maharaj, who were all very great souls. So it happened that one of the descendants of Dhruva Maharaj, he got married, somehow he took a wife, who was the daughter of death personified. And because he accepted this woman as his wife, they had a son who was not good quality. They had a son called Vena. He was a very nasty, cruel person. He would play with his friends and he would kill them. So he was really a really nasty person. Everyone was afraid of him. They saw him coming, they would just run the other way. Everyone just wanted to avoid him. They would say, oh, here comes cruel Vena. And they would just run, go away. Anyway, Vena, he was so bad that eventually the brahmanas had to curse him. And just by the curse, just by the words of the brahmanas, Vena died. But the mother, you know, mothers being what they are, they're very attached to their children. And so the mother felt very sorry for her son. She preserved the body of her dead son. So when Vena was dead, it happened that there was no king, because Vena was the king. But they killed the king, there was no king. So it meant all the thieves and the dacoits and the mafia and the gangsters and all that, they all became very active because there was nobody there to check them. There was nobody there to stop their nefarious activities. So the brahmanas thought, we have to try to do something about this. The brahmanas felt compassion on the people because they saw that innocent people suffering, how their homes were being terrorized and the young women were being taken advantage of. Nobody was safe. So the brahmanas understood that the body of Vena was there. So from the body of Vena, from the legs, they churned out a personality who came out from the legs of Vena. That person was Bahuka.
Nisarana.
Huh? was a dwarf size with short arms. Very dark skin and very like pygmies. So he was the embodiment of all the evil qualities. So this person, his nature was to steal and to kill, give trouble to others. So this person who came out from the legs of Vena, he was put in the jungle, to live in the jungle, in the forest, and like that. But then, they continued, the brahmanas and children from the arms of Putumaya, from the arms of the dead king, because they thought that although Vena's dead, that actually he has some of the qualities because he's born in the line of Dhruva Maharaj. He's one of the descendants in the line of Dhruva Maharaj. So he has some of the qualities of Dhruva Maharaj. So they want to take advantage of that, of these qualities. Although Vena was a bad person because the mother was coming from an inauspicious background, they had killed him, but still they thought that there's some good qualities in him because he's coming in the line of Dhruva Maharaj. So they turned the arms of Vena from the arms Prithu Maharaj. Prithu Maharaj came. And Prithu Maharaj, it was necessary to restore the law and order on the planet, and also the situation on the planet had become so bad that there was no food anymore. Mother Earth had stopped yielding all the different grains. So Prithu Maharaj had to go about chastising Mother Earth and getting her to yield crops so that people could get food, proper food. So Prithu Maharaj had to do this kind of thing. He was a very great, powerful personality. Because he's coming from the line of Dhruva Maharaj, and he was produced by the mantras of the Brahmanas. So Prithu Maharaj is Shaktavesha Avatar. He's empowered with the energy. And he did wonderful things, particularly he is the example of somebody who achieved perfection by worship of the Lord. The nine processes of devotional service, we have Maharaj Parikshit achieved perfection by hearing, Sukadeva by chanting, Prahlad by remembering, and Akrura by offering prayers. And it was Prithu Maharaj who achieved perfection by worshipping the Lord, by his worship. And he performed great sacrifices. His yajnas were so powerful. At one point, he had performed 99 Ashwamedha Yajna. And he was going to, if he did the 100, then he would be equal to Indra. So Indra didn't want anybody to be equal to him. So Indra stole away the horse. Indra disguised himself. Indra Sanyasi, he came and stole the horse. And Prithu Maharaj wants to get back the horse so that he can do the yajna. But they came to Prithu Maharaj and they told him, you know, just leave it, don't be attached. Indra's attached. You shouldn't be attached like him. Point is, somebody's attached, somebody's, you know, not very nice, envious, nasty. We should tolerate. So the Lord gave instructions like that to Prithu Maharaj. That just tolerate, don't worry, you've done 99 yajnas, leave it at that. Be satisfied. done 99 years. You don't have to do 100 years. So it happened like that. Bhikkhu Maharaj then accepted the desire of the Lord. And he got the earth to start yielding crops. At first the people, he thought maybe there's no crops because the people are lazy. He thought maybe the people are just lazy and not working. But then he saw that the people were actually working, they were actually trying hard. They just were not getting any crops, nothing would grow. They would plow the fields, they would plant, nothing would grow. So Prithu Maharaj understood this is because of Bhumi, Mother Earth. She's not yielding any crops. So Maharaj Prithu then performed yajna and he got Bhumi to appear and forced her to start producing crops so that the people could have food. So this was the greatness of Prithu Maharaj, that he could do things like that. He would do yajna, and the Sanat Kumar and the Kumaras, they would appear in the yajna. So he was a very great, powerful personality. And another thing which he did was also, he flattened the earth, because everywhere there were mountains and hills and things, and difficult for the people to do farming, to grow things. So he leveled the earth. And there's even one kund there in Mayapur, just beside the temple of Murari Gupta. If you look over from Murari Gupta's temple, you look across to the yoga peak. In between the two, you can see that is called Prithu Kund. The Prithu Maharaj has made a lake there. So Prithu Maharaj was a very great personality. He did many wonderful activities and he's glorified here. However, in the purport, Prabhupada is explaining how this word Bhagavan, that it's only used for certain people. Not only it's used for describing the Supreme Lord, but it can also be used to describe other persons who are empowered by the Lord to perform wonderful activities. And we have examples, people like Lord Brahma and Narada Muni and Lord Shiva. Sometimes they're all described as Bhagavan. So Bhagavan means, of course, one who possesses opulences. So these, we see in the Bhagavad Gita, when Lord Krishna speaks, it says Sri Bhagavan Uvacha. And when Arjuna speaks, it's simply Arjuna Uvacha. So Lord Krishna is identified as Bhagavan. But other people also get the name Bhagavan. It's also given other personalities. But these other personalities, they're not ordinary people. Okay, we do find a lot of ordinary people, they've also got the name Bhagavan. There was this one Sindhi young man who used to come to our temple in Hong Kong. He was a real useless person. Totally useless. But you know, his name was Bhagavan. So, probably you know a few people with the name Bhagavan also. Well, he's a
devotee.
He's Das, in the state of our line, Das. That's different. But people, sometimes the parents, they give the name Bhagavan to their son or something. So, the name Bhagavan is actually meant for special personalities, people who are empowered. Empowered to do the work, activities on behalf of the Supreme Lord. Just like spreading the holy name. It is said, Kali Yuga Dham Harinam Sankirtan Krishna Shakti Vininahi Tara Prabhupan. That the Dharma for the Kali Yuga is the chanting of the holy name. But unless one is empowered with Krishna Shakti, one is not empowered to distribute, to spread the holy name. There, you have to have that empowerment from the Lord directly. And that idea of empowerment is there, just like if you're involved in some legal case. If you have sometimes you may have some legal case pending and you may hire a lawyer to represent you. So the lawyer is the representative of the person. So in the same way, the devotee is the representative of Krishna. He's empowered to act on behalf of Lord Krishna, to distribute the holy name and to give Krishna consciousness. Without having that empowerment, you won't be able to distribute the holy name. You can't do anything. There has to be that empowerment. Just like the electricity, there has to be the connection to the power station. There has to be the generation of electricity in the power station, and there has to be the proper connection all the way to the power source so that the electricity is supplied. So the same way, there has to be connection to the Supreme Lord. And that connection to the Lord comes through the parampara, through the disciplic succession. And that's why connection to the disciplic succession is so important. That we can be empowered to perform activities which appear to be impossible. People all thought that what Prabhupada was doing was impossible. Prabhupada was telling people, I'm going to go to the West, I'm going to spread Krishna consciousness. And people just thought, oh yeah, sure. You know, Prabhupada was already 60s, not young man. He was just living in Vrindavan, no money, not very well known, wasn't a big sannyasi or anything. But he was telling people, I'm going to go to the West, I'm going to go. And people, nobody thought very much of it. It's just saying, he's got some dream, but not so easy thing. But Prabhupada was connected. He was very firmly connected to his spiritual master. He understood how much it was the desire of the spiritual master, and it was the desire of Lord Chaitanya also, because Lord Chaitanya had predicted the holy name would be spread to every town and village. So some people thought this is just poetry, this is just make-believe, it's not really true, it will never happen. I remember one time I was in the Philippines. So I met this one group of people. There was this one man, he was a lawyer. And he had a group of followers, you know. And he called themselves, they were the kingdom for the brown race. Right? They said, this earth belongs to the people because our skin is the same color as the earth. So the earth, this planet belongs to us. So he actually had all these people, and you had, you're the representative for Russia, and you're the representative for America. And each of the followers, he had them, you know, you're the representative of this country, that country, you know. None of them ever went anywhere. They all sat in this little town in Davao, in the south of the Philippines there. And they thought, yes, I'm the representative for the army in Africa and for the army in America. And nobody ever left Davao, you know. No one ever left the town. It was all make-believe. So, you know, sometimes people thought Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's prediction is a bit like that, that, oh, it will never happen, the name can never really happen. But other people had faith that they actually understood, no, it can happen, it's going to happen. And certainly Prabhupada went there with that conviction. And although it was very difficult and there were many challenges, somehow he was able to do it. He was able to begin. Of course, after Prabhupada, people came along, and, you know, you've got people coming along and saying, oh, there's so many people give Vaidhi Bhakti. I've come to give the highest thing. I'm giving Baba Bhakti. I'm giving this, you know. So you get people like, you know, they talk like this, you know. But they don't appreciate how much one had to undergo in order just to establish Vaidhi Bhakti in people, to bring people to devotional service. To want to give them Baba Bhakti, yeah, you can talk about it, but we want to see it, you know, to actually see it. It's going to take time, it's going to take a lot of time. But what's important is the groundwork. If you don't have the groundwork, if you don't have the foundation, then you can never bring people to Baba Bhakti. You bring to give people Baba Bhakti. This one man is saying, I'm giving something more than Vaidhi Bhakti. I'm giving Baba Bhakti. And this is what all the great acharyas gave, yeah. But, you know, none of the previous acharyas have gone around the world to distribute Krishna consciousness. They have all just been in India, and they just sat in Vrindavan and in the holy places. And they did Baba Bhakti, they certainly they were doing Baba Bhakti or Raghunatha Bhakti. But, you know, they didn't actually distribute it to the world. That work was left for people who were empowered to do that. So Prabhupada had that kind of empowerment that he could go. And by his empowerment, he could empower other people. He could send people to Australia Devotees went to Australia with no books and with no money, and still they were able to establish Krishna consciousness. They were able to get devotees. And then people went to England, and they did also wonderful things, wonderful preaching there, and they were able to contact famous people and do things like make the Govinda record and the Hare Krishna mantra recording and make it famous all over Europe and in the Western world. So that was all coming from Prabhupada's empowerment. And Prabhupada's empowerment is coming from his spiritual teacher. And it's all coming ultimately from Lord Krishna, that Krishna Shakti. So similarly, Pritam Maharaj, great devotee, he's empowered and he performed wonderful activities. So he's described as Bhagavata Puran. Right? We have the Bhagavata, Srimad Bhagavata, which is the pastimes and the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And we have also this word Bhagavan, which is coming from Bhagavan. And many people are called Bhagavan. And in the, not many, but Prabhupada saying, special people, empowered souls, who can perform wonderful activities on behalf of the Lord, not an ordinary thing. So Prithu Maharaj was that kind of personality, a very great personality. So great that he's recorded here for the major portion of the fourth canto here, the pastimes of Prithu Maharaj, and how he did so many wonderful things on the earth. He re-established religious principles, and he showed the proper way to worship the Lord by sacrifice. So, in this way we are remembering him. He is the representative of the Lord. Alright, is there any questions or comments?
Chinese, yes. Not Thai people. Chinese, I think. Whatever. But I was thinking, how come now this religion like Muslim or even Christianity, whether it's Europe or Thai or even India, spreading like anything? And people saying sometimes, they have the internet people, like they fighting with Hindu religion. You people, all energy now coming from Allah, and you people useless. There's no energy. Allah Shakti Vina Nahi Parvartha. Because you can see, so much happening, and you guys, nothing happening. You people Hindu destroying yourself. They're doing like that. And nowadays, we don't even use it. Hindu, Rashtra in Nepal, and communists. So, how to say people when they will put the same argument? Jesus Christ Shakti Vina Nahi Parvartha. You see, in every village, we have 3, 4, 5 churches already. In Nepal, and you people, and I was thinking, it's true. How come Shakti going to Jesus Christ or to Allah more than sometimes it's happening to Krishna? What could be the answer?
Well, Jesus Christ is also an empowered representative of God. He is also Shakti Vishnu. So people who have faith in him, they can also be empowered to spread the holy name. Prophet Allah, Prophet Muhammad and Jesus Christ are both glorified in Prabhupada's purport in the Srimad Bhagavatam. In the second canto there, you'll see, I think second canto, fourth chapter, or third chapter, third or fourth chapter. Anyway, they're both mentioned there, and Prabhupada glorifies them, that they have done very wonderful things to uplift the people. They have done great things because of them, people have faith in God. Christian or Muslim, you know, they're bona fide religious processes. They believe in God. They worship God. They have their own ways. Of course, there may be some deviations and different things we could argue about how they interpret their scriptures, how they follow. But still, they believe in God. They have that pride. You know, at least they have some faith. And that's good. We're not against other religions. We recognize that there are different ways to God. We don't say only God, only one way, only by Krishna. We accept that there are other faiths, other traditions. And we respect them for that.
Doesn't mean that the face is the name after which determines the energy flow and change of the environment.
Well, certainly faith, everybody has to have some faith, yes. You have to have a belief, you have to have some faith. You're going to believe in something, that is faith. Their religion, they can change their name, they can change the name of their religion. Somebody could be a, you know, somebody may be a Hindu and he may marry a Christian, so you have to become a Christian. Or if you marry a Muslim girl, you have to become a Muslim. We had one devotee, there was one devotee in Malaysia, and he married a Muslim girl and became a Muslim for some time. but didn't mean you changed your belief. You know, just because you change your religion. Actually, Prabhupada said there's only one God, so there's only one religion. And real religion means to love God. Whether you're Christian or Muslim or Hindu or whatever, that's not important. What's important is that you love God. And that's the real religion. No, we're not against other religions. And we're happy to see people have belief in God. Just like the Pope, some years ago the Pope became and thousands of people all came to see him. He's got thousands of followers. That was maybe the previous Pope. Anyway, you know, the heads of religion, they attract a lot of people. They have that shakti. They can attract a lot of people. And that encourages their faith.
Like, I work in the Christian university, and the brothers in the opening of every semester, they give a speech, and then they say that we should have faith in God. And they have many practices, at least, you know, spiritual practices also, whereby they encourage other practices. They're Muslims also, they also support our Indians, you know. So I think I would be better, I'm happy to be working for a Christian organization than for a Karmi. Maybe they are not like whatever exactly we are practicing, but at least it's better than working just for a mundane person who just have, you know, profit oriented, you know. And I see they have a nice summer, they have these brothers of Saint Gabriel. Maybe they are not practicing everything, you know, and maybe they like the regulative principle of eating meat or something like that. But there's few of them, brothers and the teachers, they come, they appreciate. I think even yesterday they had a Rath Yatra, some of the Achan Thambi, you know, they appreciate it. And they come sometimes to the center, they at least appreciate, say that we're doing nice work, we are happy. And then, so I think that we should see that, you know, different, they are leading to the same goal, like sun, right?
So, you can see that my question was, I can, recently we went with Mahaprabhu and other our leaders in India, they are a spiritual organization, and they have huge college for 3,000 students and monks teaching there. And they, all their followers becoming their followers. And then we went to another organization, and they have huge university. And here we have a Christian university. Then we're wondering, why do we have Hare Krishna University?
Well, they have things like Ramakrishna University, Vivekananda University, Maharishi University.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Maharishi Shakti Vidana Hipparvata, what kind of Shakti Vidana Hipparvata? And I'm just wondering in that way, so how nice would be if we can have huge Bhaktivedanta University with thousands of students. So from where, I'm just wondering and praying, from where to get that Shakti? Why na Prabhupada was happening.
Well, for one thing, Prabhupada wasn't too much interested in those kind of things. Prabhupada didn't care so much for mundane educational institutes. He was, he said, we're a spiritual organization. He didn't care so much for mundane institutions. Well, his godbrother, Bon Maharaj, of course, he has that mundane educational institute, just across from Krishna Balaram Mandir. Prabhupada didn't appreciate these things. And things like hospitals, Prabhupada also didn't give so much for that. If people want to do it, let them do it. But those people, they're not the very spiritual kind of people. You know, they're very much congregation and not very focused on spiritual goals. Have their own attachments to the material thing. Okay, but people come along, you know, they want to do something, okay, they can do that. They like to do it, they can do it for Krishna. Just like nowadays we have in England, they have the Avanti school. They have Avanti school. And the Queen went one time on. Becomes a mundane institute. It takes up the mundane education.
What Prabhupada was saying about Varnashrama Dharma, I'm just trying really to think what Prabhupada said, that 50% of my work still yet to be done, isn't it?
When somebody said that, Prabhupada said, hey, that's not very nice. He said, you're saying like that, Prabhupada didn't like that so much. When Brahmananda said that, Prabhupada told me, I said, well, that's not very nice of you. I said, I've only done 50% of my work. Prabhupada didn't do that good. Well, Brahmananda said that, but it wasn't, Prabhupada didn't like it. I said, come on, I've done more than 50%.
Is that in Rabi Maharaj, I met one professor from Mahachula University. He was asking, do you know that from Nepal hundreds of children are coming here to study? And I said, I know some of them are in ABAC, some in Webster University, some in Chulalongkorn, but I don't know, hundreds are coming. And he said, no, they specially come for spiritual education. And I said, oh really, what spiritual education? And then he started explaining, it was really amazing news, Maharaj. He said that around 400 boys are from Nepal here in Thailand, and they bring them at the age of like the small boys. And they bring them here, and they're from Hindu background or whatever. And they bring them here and they give them Buddhist education. They're wearing dress like monk, like nuns, they call it, small nuns. And they, now the eldest one is 22 years old, and he's Pakka monk now, Buddhist monk. And now they know Thai, they know everything, and they're preaching now Buddhism. And every year they bring in more Nepalese boys from Nepal, and they're giving them Buddhist training. And by the time they grow elderly, I mean old, they already Pakka Buddhist monk, but they're born Hindus. I was like, I didn't know about this organization. And he said, I'll share you. Very nice, very nice. You guys doing so good, isn't it? I was like, okay.
Yeah, they're taking advantage of poor families.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes. Yeah. They said that they're all from poor families.
Right. That should be stopped. That's not proper. That's not legal to do things like that.
Christians
do
the same thing, brother. Christians do the same thing. They're actually taking that training, sending it to us.
You give some money to the poor family and you get that son.
They said that we educate your children in the civilized country. So they'll take the... And they give proper education also. All math, science, English, very nice. but at the same time, they make them monk when they graduate. He was saying only two people they have left monastery. Only two boys left monastery till now, out of 400. He said that if you come to here, Bangkok, I can take you to this community, he said. I said, okay, we'll come and see him.
Maharaj, you know, we went to Swami Narayana temple recently. They have huge followers. And you are right, maybe 90% of them, they really kind of only focus on mundane. But they become higher topper in society, topper, like ministers and IITs. And the 10% of them, they becoming sannyasis. Because they becoming such a top sannyasis. I mean, you will see, 7 years of training, they, after the next stage, they go Sanskrit, they are very, very high level, and they appreciating Prabhupada. They even give us chance to give Bhagavatam class for 400 monks of their monks. They're very kind. But what they do, they put in this network of the mundane education, so-called, but they're highly disciplined. Nobody of all those people have mobile telephone. No, they kind of semi-military training monk education. But then 10% of them, maybe 100 people becoming monks, sannyasis. And they are actually so amazingly top sannyasis that I was surprised the system of education. Maybe Srila Prabhupada definitely he was against mundane education and Bhagavan Swami was with it. But when we do follow up, they're so like Christians, so many followers of Jesus Christ becoming priests. And then they're coming to Nepal and making many, many churches now in Nepal. Because they took them from poor background, trained them, and sent them back to Nepal. Now they're top preachers. And they're not changing their names. They're Brahmanas. They're keeping the same Keshav, Acharya, Christian priest. For low people, they're changing the names. Mary, Peter. But for Brahmanas, they're not changing. So the top priest is a Brahmana. Keshav Acharya. And he preaching Jesus Christ Bible. And it's such a strategy. So I was just thinking, maybe this is something you have to change in the script and to use Anukulya Sri Krishna or something so you can attract more people and you can choose from that network. That's what my thought. And it's very true that Prabhupada was against all these things. But our thoughts, how to penetrate society to attract this low-thinking people, close to Krishna.
They target a particular level of society. They go to the poorest people. Just like in Malaysia, right? The Christians also, they go to the mountain region, they go to the tribal people, they convert them. So that kind of conversion, you know, I don't think it's not like they came in of their own choice, but it was more from the circumstances which they were in. They found themselves in certain circumstances.
I think the mass of Hindus, they are not educating their own people. So they take advantage. So they can't say anything in their Hinduism.
The Hindu people are not educated.
And they are, see, Krishna consciousness, education is just something different. They can accept. But they themselves not.
That's why people government appreciate recently, government appreciate. Oh, you are having some systematic education. They never thought about them. So that's what systemic communication should be through the content. Because we say in Russian, your place will never be empty. If you not do it, they'll do it. If we will not do it, they'll do it. And so, and we say also in Russian, don't blame the mirror if you have ugly face. And when you have millions of followers for them, then don't blame them because they were smarter than you. They went to that society, they don't know them. So that's very important. And, but at the same time, not to become too mundane, like Maharaj said. You should not near to near for you. You get big fish without getting away.
I think like Maharaj said, like I think in the poor we want to have like some brahmachari, sannyasis who are preaching the pure mission, right? Mm-hmm. But like in Bhakti Viksha or like in India we see the base, I think this is also like the base. So then SPAN is also doing this kind of projects to facilitate, you know, like, you know, students and also in the hospital. So congregation people have to do that because they have to maintain the family, sustain. So, but not like the poor of SPAN should not just go for that, that kind of
part. But it can be like, right, 1,200 poor sannyasi, 1,200. They never mix in this congregation. And congregation never getting initiation, you know that? They never giving initiation to congregation. You be only own. They go Harijanas, Hari Bhaktas. And they never getting initiation in their life, for example. But they are so dedicated. And then every day they have in temple 500 volunteers. Business people, internet people, volunteers. No paying money, nothing. And they're not giving any initiation. In the strict rules they have for course and yeses. No even single brahmacharya will survive in this country. That's strong rules they have. They never eating anything, not even salt. They're mixing everything together, no any enjoyment, nothing. And still they have 1,200 singles. Poor.
Amazing thing is they said that we learned from this school.
And they said yes.
Yeah.
I
we are inspired by this God.
We learn from you people. From 1985, we learn from you people.
Their followers mostly are coming from their community, from the Gujarati Kutch, that region there. Where that Swami Narayan place is, most of them they all come from there.
Gujarati?
Yeah.
And the big temple in Dubai.
Oh yeah, they've got it done. They've got their factory producing units to create a new temple. You want a temple, they'll ship it to you, you know, containers, and you can just build it yourself. They've got it all in units, they just put it together. Just like, you know, you get the artisans, you get the single sign, you get them made in India and put them together. We've got whole temples like that.
Whole temples, Maharaj?
Is it not something we have to learn from them? Well, I mean, why not? And you're struggling for 90% of time collecting that membership. And we just have to shift temples. Okay, you want temple, shift okay. And you spend your time for preaching better.
I also went to Swaminarayan Temple in London, very nice, but as Maharaj is saying, I think most of them are from a particular community. Like let's say we are here, right, now here, let's say. We are not all like the relatives of, from the same community, you know. Some are Thai, Chinese, you know. And Maharaj, so it's like I think more coming out of natural attraction and then, you know, for mission, for Prabhupada, something there, but I think they are targeting their own community, so it's much easier. Like let's say in Bankek, or if you want to target only a particular community, it's much easier. But if you want to go that barrier, try to attack people based on their faith or their attraction for the Lord, then it's more difficult. Right? Sometimes you can see if you want to have Chinese people, Thai people, and international crowd, putting them together is more difficult than just getting a, you know, 10 times the number like with the same community. Like if you want to get only Tamil people in Malaysia, it's much easier. Or Nepalese people here, you can have 1,000 people. But if you want to have Nepalese, Chinese and Thai, you know, break that barrier, then it's much more difficult. I think that's what Prabhupada did, no? I think Prabhupada had thousands of disciples from different backgrounds. And that's
actually the very first thing that Prabhupada did. I asked many followers of Prabhupada, so much attention to the quality of Prabhupada. Very much. Not to philosophy, nobody knows philosophy. They very much attracted to this name, the Prabhupada. The Prabhupada, he was living in the transparent room.
as glasses, you know. So everybody can come and see the very good. So example is of the contracted prayer. Because of God, because of philosophy. That's true, there's a point of faith family can be attracted much easier. But people are attracted to Prabhupada's quality. I was attracted to Prabhupada's quality, not to philosophy. I was attracted to the quality of Nrsimha Maharaj, of Jayaprak Maharaj. I was attracted to the personality. Then I came to philosophy later. It's also important that everybody should be exemplary for the appearance of the
I heard there was this one Swami Narayan Sannyasi. He wanted to go home. He didn't want to be Sannyasi anymore. The family told him, no, don't come home.
Yeah, they
said, no, we don't want you to come back.
No, actually, one joke like this. Like one guy said to one sadhu, you know, I have so many problems in the house, no money. Give me 1 month and I will solve the problems. I don't have money for your son. Okay, you do one, I will hide you for 1 month in my ashram. Okay, that's all. Okay. And then you can see. Okay, agree. And I will get everything. Hey, don't worry, wife, children, everything you get. And then after some time, he went to the house and said, Your husband died, finished. Oh, really? After 1 month, this husband coming from the ashram, he doesn't know that sadhu told him. He coming, some music party going on. Some music party. What's going on in my home? He coming, and everybody shocked. Hey, father coming. You died. And then wife took him aside and said, why did you come? Because you died, and all villagers felt so much compassion to us. So they gave us then in charge of our village. He sent my son to America to study. It was no husband, okay, we have to help this family. They took our daughter and gave in marriage to somebody very, very very nice man. Now marriage going on because people helping us. Because they're thinking you died. And now you're coming back, get lost. And that man went to Syria.
Hare Krishna. It's only BBB Narasimha Swami Maharaj ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaura Bhaktavinda ki.